Okay, it's a bit slow. Here we go. Oh no, the rainbow. Okay, I think you can see it, and I cannot see you right now, but I'm very happy to be here. It's funny, this is a time of the year when there's so much gender-related stuff is usually happening because March is coming. It's not a coincidence I requested this time to have a talk when Zoli asked me if I'm interested. So my name is Orsolya Vasarhelyi, but everybody calls me Orshi because it's very complicated to actually pronounce it. I consider myself as a computational social scientist, which is this weird person, which is kind of a data scientist, kind of a sociologist, and then the computer science, and it's all around. And we are the people who are trying to use large scale data to understand complicated social phenomena. I've been all around the place. You can read it, you can check my LinkedIn, but what I'm very proud of is I'm currently an ambassador of the Women of Data Science, which is a big conference at Stanford University every year. And I'm a super proud organizer of the first ever Central and Eastern European version of this, which will happen soon. So on the 8th of March, we're gonna do the first ever Central and Eastern European Women in Data Science online, like similar to this event. The pandemic allowed us actually to do something bigger than usual. And we have amazing people from Austria, Bosnia, Croatia, Hungary, Serbia, Slovenia, and Romania. And you can join for free. It's for 6 hours. Just bump in. Our agenda is out. Join us. I think it's going to be really good. And we hope one day we can do a face-to-face event. So that was the intro, who I am. So what I'm actually going to talk about, I mean, I guess I need to explain why I want to talk in a data science conference about gender equality or equality in a nutshell. I promise you it's not going to be like an explainable AI talk, which you had a couple of months ago. It's a bit different. Then I will talk about the research I've been doing using data science techniques to understand mainly unconscious bias in STEM, which is science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. And then I thought, it's great that the academics are talking about what we find and like, oh, it's sad, what should we do, or not sad, unfortunately it's sad. What I want to finish my talk is it's some very basic ideas about how we can eliminate bias in our everyday work as data scientists, and you know, just finish with that. Please ask questions, please debate whatever I say, because I think that's what really will help us not having bias later on. So STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, beautiful word. You're gonna hear in the next couple of weeks even more that yes, we are, there's a lack of women. Also in academics, also in industry, it's like 30-25%. The truth is there's actually no real number. We don't really know how many percent of the people working in this field are considered themselves women. And it's very common that in the industry, when the HR reports are coming out, like, yes, we have 20% women, but we don't really know who is actually in a technical role. It's very common that the HR is counted in. And in the research industry, I mean, yeah, you might have 30%, but most of them might be just PhD students. So it's really not clear. But this is not what usually, or it's not the main reason I was very into understanding this field a little bit better. It's more like the fact that more than 50% of the women who work in like any computing related job, they are really, really likely to drop out from the field. And it's very sad for many ways. One of them is like these people invested into a career and they switch to non-technical roles for many reasons. It could be personal, but many times it's cultural or organizational or family conflict and so on. And this is very alarming, and this is something we can do something, I believe so. Another thing which you will probably also hear in a couple of weeks in this March when we talk about gender equality a lot, that according to the World Economic Forum is at least like 257 years to close the gender pay gap. And what is a very interesting part of the research they've been doing, that they showed that actually the fact that there's very low representation of women in STEM is enlarged the gender pay gap. We know that in these careers, people usually earn more than in other ones. And the fact that we have like 20 or 30% women is actually making the gender pay gap bigger.
And as data scientist, here comes the scary part, I would say, when, you know, I have to show you that, yeah, there is issues with gender inequality in the products what we are developing. These are, you know, very known examples that how we put our biases into products, right? And any of us can do that when we are developing something or working on something. And as companies are moving forward with AI, without not of trying to pay attention, but not really paying attention of like diversity of their teams or the way they are thinking about it, it's clear and it's getting clearer and clearer that like most of the stereotypes what we have inside, we all have, I do have as well, we are building them inside the product and we just making them much bigger. That's the book what I added today, which is a popular one, is talking about as well. And we or none of us wants to, you know, like have a headline like this. I mean, there is good media and bad media, but I don't think it's the goal. So my research focuses on how unconscious bias is manifest into teamwork and how it impacts teams and individual success. And I try to pick like two examples, which I think is the, I don't know, it's the closest to us to understand what I mean by unconscious bias and gender equality. So what large-scale data can teach us about unconscious bias, right? That's what I will talk about. The first one, the first project, which is actually two thing I've been working on but joined, it has this very beautiful thing called gender typicality of behavior predicts success and in programming and arts. Complicated, but it's not that complicated. So what is gender typicality or gendered behavior? So the weird thing about the computational social science is that we use computer science, but we use social science too in order to test already existing theories on big data. So originally, gender discrimination is conceptualized as like a categorical discrimination against women usually. So I don't know, I'm a woman, so if I'm working on GitHub, this project is going to be about GitHub data. I don't know, someone see my name is like visibly feminine and they might have some kind of, you know, unconscious bias towards me. Like, ah, probably she doesn't write that good code and I'm not going to accept her pull request. That would be the categorical gender discrimination. However, most of the scholars in gender studies has been long talking about that if we really want to understand inequalities, gender-related inequalities, we need to focus our interest to the gendered forms of behavior, which is more like the extent of what kind of actions is typical for a man and for a woman. And this is where actually bias can happen. And the society works in a way that when people do certain type of jobs, which is not as you expect, then that can result in kind of bias. So it's when you hear about a kindergarten teacher who is a man, many people will like, oh, that's weird. And that can actually drive into unconscious bias. And this is what we were after in this project in an online setting. So on the original project, we used data from GitHub, where we know there's like in open source software development, there's like 10% or less like women. Also known that there are some kind of bias, like for example, lower pull request acceptance or like women have like many times lower, I don't know, number of stars is lower on their repositories. And there's some kind of bias, but it's not super clear what's going on there and what caused that. So what we were interested in this project is whether women are at a disadvantage because of like who they are, like categorical gender discrimination, or what they do. Is there a certain type of behavior, this gendered behavior, does it manifest itself into the online sphere as well? So the first thing we had to do is somehow gather data and measure this gendered behavior, which is not really straightforward, but we managed to do it in a way. So what we did is, first of all, we inferred the gender of, I think, like 8 million people based on their names. And we built a random forest prediction based on the activities of the user, what we also inferred from GitHub, whether they are women or men. So basically what the using these variables, we predicted someone's gender, I mean, if it's a woman or not. And the very important I would say, methodological decision what we made. We're going to only use variables which are under the control of the individual. So if we're talking about gendered behavior, I want to pick things what I decide, like what is my specialty? Am I in front-end development or I do data science? How active I am, because my activity can be something which, you know, predicts my behavior. And what type of people I'm working with? Am I working with more with women or men? How many are there? And so on. But for example, we didn't have the information like who are following me, because I don't control that, right? It's not something I can use as something I want to control. And what you can see here is like in a world where there's less than 10% of women, the number one predictor of being female on GitHub is like having female collaborators, which is a known fact in social sciences that when you have a minority and majority setting, people obviously feel more safe to work with people who they might know or similar to them. And, but, you know, we are predicting everybody with this method. So what we do after we run this prediction, you know, it's a runner for us. So it's like there's a kind of a classifier in the end, and if, because it's a regressor, it has a number between 0 and 1. And this is calculated for everyone, for people who are men and for people who we don't know their gender. So we have a number for everybody between 0 and 1, how likely that they are women. So 1 means we are really sure that they are women based on their behavior, and 0 means that no, it's probably a man, right? We are very sure. It's not a perfect prediction, thank God. And probably it could be forced to be even better. I think like F1 score was like 0.8. So it's not bad based on only these things. And we use this number, which is between 0 and 1, what we call femaleness, which is the gendered behavior, to predict the success and the survival of the people in this system. So we have like 2 models, I mean, a lot of other ones, but like 2 main models to predict the success of men and women, or like everyone's success, the femaleness and a lot of control variables and the survival. What is success in this sense? We measure success as the number of stars on someone's own repository on GitHub. No teamwork involved here. It's just like my personal visibility or career or whatever. Teams are on the second example. And what we see here, so this one on the left is a marginal plot, which means that the zero inflated negative binomial model's results, this is the prediction, the red one stereotypically for women and the blue one for men. So what we do see here, so in the model, gender femaleness, the variable which captures gendered behavior, was a very significant and important predictor of success. And what we see here, there's a negative slope. What in regression models, negative slope means the bigger, the more female-like your behavior is, the less successful you are, simply saying. But another important thing what we see, there's not much difference between the 2 lines. What does that indicate? That the categorical gender, which was also in the model, is not significant. So people are not in a disadvantage because of their gender. There is this gendered behavior, what we see in the previous slides, that I'm working with women and I'm working in front end, and the combination of these is something what puts women and men as well into a disadvantage. And we see very similar thing in the case of survival, where survival means that we had data collection, I think finished in 2016. And a year later, we went back to our sample and check whether the people are still active on the platform or not. I know it doesn't necessarily mean if I'm not active on GitHub, I gave up with coding, or I don't know, I could change my... There's many ways that we can say that people are not active anymore. It doesn't mean survival. But what we see here, that the femaleness of behavior also has a negative relationship with survival. So people who are having highly female-like behavior are less likely to survive. But a big difference here is that there is a difference between men and women, which means that the categorical gender discrimination or disadvantage is actually here, and in the case of survival, is there. We also ran this stuff for unknowns, people who are trying to hide their gender, or we couldn't, you know, infer it, and it was even worse for them. So what we see here that men has always a little bit higher probability of surviving, even though if they have like a very female-like behavior. So there is there. Okay, we see that on GitHub. Great, I published the paper. You know, I could get my PhD. It's always great. But, you know, it's just one study. One study is, you know, you need three or more to figure out is it really true. We are in the process of doing the second study because we want to see whether it is it's a general phenomena, right? So can we capture gendered behavior in different online platforms? And as I'm moving, as our life is actually moving online more, it's more and more important that whether unconscious bias built into our online success, and that's how we sell ourselves. So we moved into a very similar platform. It's called Behance, which I call the GitHub of the designers, which is, I know it's not the best way to put it, but it's very similar. But here there are some important differences. First of all, there's much more women there, like 30-40%. And then there's design, there's art, there's UX, good stereotypical things that it's more feminine. There shouldn't be such a phenomenon. But we also know that women's work in this context also receive less attention. And so what we were interested by repeating the study in this data is whether the negative impact of gendered behavior penalize the users on this platform as well. So we repeated the study, but we did a little bit of different stuff. One of the obviously many critiques the previous study received was that when we were predicting someone's whether someone is a woman or a man, we used the gender of the collaborators. And you can debate how much is really under the control of the individual. So maybe I'm sending a bunch of pull requests to a lot of guys, but they just don't accept it. So I end up working with women. And then it's not really, you know, my true decision, who am I working with? So we removed these variables from the femaleness conceptualization. On the left, you can see the GitHub ones. These are variable importances. And this is Behance. And we created the same femaleness, a little bit less accurate, as far as the number 0.67. And you see that actually, I mean, you won't see because you don't have the other chart there, but the order is very similar. And then we see in GitHub and the hands that different specializations are also important, activity and followed users. So how the prediction looks like with these new variables and putting GitHub and also Behance there. One other important thing is that we added one more like outcome variable. So I would say that you can consider survival as a kind of success as well. And we had attention. Attention is the number of followers. And there is a very, let's say, well-known effect in science, technology, and engineering, and in many fields, where, which is lack of women, that women have a paradox visibility. It's paradox visibility that we are especially, you know, like visible in the field because there's not many people like us, but often overlooked as experts, like, yeah, she's going to get the job. She's a girl. Everybody wants a girl, right? So we wanted to see if there is high attention is there and how does it, you know, work with the femaleness. So we have the number of followers, and basically what you see in both cases, the predicted success, attention for women, there is a gap, a positive gap to women. Over, I mean, the femaleness, the slope is negative everywhere. You really see the same thing, very similar results in the case that like more female like your behavior, you are penalized. But in the case of attention, in both cases, actually being a woman mitigates that. So your prediction is zero. Like if you are fully, if you have like zero female-like behavior, you will be still more, you know, visible. So there is this visibility. But in the other two cases, you can see that there is this negative slope, and it seems like that this, let's say the way this unconscious bias towards like, okay, this is like these people doing more female-like stuff. There is a disadvantage. So that's where we are right now with this study. We are still working on it. And I hope we can figure out other sources to see it. And the second project I want to briefly talk about is about teams. Because, I mean, I think most of us really works in teams. I mean, most of the creative processes, and especially in software development or in technology, we create stuff in teams. And this is about gender diversity and inclusion. So the reason we were interested in this topic is that I don't think I have to tell all of you that the last, I don't know, let's say 5-10 years has been full of scandals coming from the tech industry. There was a lot of criticism that, hey, we need more women, we need more diverse teams. And also there's research actually suggesting that there is a positive impact of diversity on creativity, maybe on success, on performance. Nobody really knows, but hoping it's there. And it's okay, it's great. Companies are trying to hire women and other underrepresented groups in every way to reflect the demographics of their customers. But there are backlashes. So for example, the Google memo incident really showed that this urgent need to bring more diversity in technology, it's not always welcomed. I mean, it can be tricky. And I think what we in general think is that what many times these companies forget that they are just trying to hire a lot of people without creating a proper culture, which we can call an inclusive culture, it's not going to work out. But there's not much study about inclusion at the moment, and we don't really know how to measure inclusion. Because inclusion is compared to, for example, the diversity reports you can download from Facebook.com, which say like we have 35% of women, it's not that easy to conceptualize because it's personal. It's how I feel and what I want to feel. And then if I feel then I'm part of things. They are, thank God, a bunch of sociologists who've been working on what inclusion is. And then from an organizational setting, there's a lot of, like, let's say, semi-objective ways to measure it, which is like people have access to information, to the management. Are they embedded into the organizational networks? Do they have ownership on their decisions? And there's a lot of other ones. Since I've been working with networks for a very long time, the way we decided to use inclusion in this setting is using the social network of a team, right? Like seeing the position of the people. So we use team networks in the video game industry to understand how teams' gender diversity and inclusion predicts the creativity of a certain game and the success. So we had like 8,500 video games and like 730,000 developers data from the 80s to 2012. So unfortunately, I cannot tell you anything about Fortnite or the games which are pretty popular right now, because mobile games, I don't know, it wanted to be the IMDb of video games, but it is not. So the data collection was pretty nice until the 2010s, but then the quality went down and they don't really put any more the credits of the teams who work on it for obvious reasons. So we have this data. But the cool thing about this data, it starts in the 80s and it's within the same industry. So we see in which project who worked with whom, so we can build up networks based on shared working experience. So we have for every game, for these 8,000 games, a lot of information about like what the features of the game, what's the perspective, the gameplay, the interface. And based on that, we I would call it rather like uniqueness of the game and not creativity, because what we do, we compare the combination of each game's, like, let's say, stylistic elements and compared to the preceding 5 years, all of those games, and calculate some costing similarities. So we have like a creativity measurement, like how unique the game is. Success is pretty straightforward. We also have the information of what the critic review says. So it's, you know, that's what the community thinks. That's what the reviewers think about the game. And success is, we know, it's not about us. It's about what the community thinks. And then we have the networks based on shared previous projects. So if I work with someone on a project, we have a tie together. If we've worked on a lot of projects together, we have a stronger tie. And we can use these networks to quantify whether, you know, how included women are in the team. There's a lot of ways to do it. The one I'm going to show you here, we use the inverse of the assortativity of the network. And assortativity is kind of a measurement of segregation and homophily. And here, what inclusion will mean, that if it has like high positive values, it indicates higher gender mixing. So it's more likely that women work with men and they are not segregated alone, right? Low values will indicate segregation. Of course, we clean the data, we have only teams which has women, and we get rid of unknowns, and all these controls are there. And then we have gender diversity, where we take the good common HR approach, ratio of women in the team. And we predict the creativity and the success of the games. And that's how they look like. What you see here in the case of creativity, of the, this is the prediction in the middle, I think it's very interesting. So as the diversity grows, so I have more and more women in the team, so they start to hire a lot of women, but I have zero inclusion. So I hire a lot of women and I leave them on the edges of the network and they are not included or they are not part of the organizational processes. The predicted creativity is the lowest. But as I hire more women and I include them, so they have shared working experience, they feel more included, that's the theory, I have a higher creativity. So let's say, in order to achieve like creativity, it's not enough just to hire a bunch of women or whatever, because it's not, you need people to feel included. And in the case of success, we never had the idea that actually a well-included gender diverse team in the video game industry will predict you very high success, because the critics are written by a very small, very, let's say, just like usually, I checked all the reviewers and I found zero women in the data. And this is not what the culture is. So it's not really happening. What you see here that in a well-included gender diverse team, very negative impact. It's not going to predict you high success by the critics. So this part has a couple of policy implications. And then I will talk about the take-home message. So what we see based on the platform economy, what we can call the design and then the GitHub case, that if we, for example, decide that we have like 20% women in every team and that it's a must, it's not going to address the problems what the gendered form of behavior will bring in. We will still have unconscious bias, even in fields where you wouldn't think that, I don't know, I will pay less for the front-end developer and more for the back-end, and that, oh, there's more girls here. And it's known from a lot of studies that fields where you bring more women in, the prestige goes down, so the salary goes down. So that quotas cannot actually solve this problem. Furthermore, if we just hire a bunch of women without, you know, connecting them in the network outcome, meaning creating an inclusive team culture, it can actually lead to diverse creative performance. And by the way, in the success case, the number one predictor of success was creativity. So you need that uniqueness to create something which will be successful. Even though inclusion is just using the creativity, it matters. So you need to think about inclusivity. And therefore, I have the critique for many of the organizations and companies who just, you know, yeah, we have the 20% women, we did our job, our homework worked well, we have a diversity management here. It's much more complicated than this, and there are good solutions and we are trying to get there, but I think there's a lot of homework for researchers, HR professionals, and people analytics professionals to work on, because it's really not enough. Okay, so sad. It is sad, as a woman especially. So what we as data scientists can actually do. So first of all, what I always try to do when I teach or I talk to people, that we have so much bias. And they are, as I showed in these examples in the beginning, we build these into the products we do. And then the first way to eliminate, to, you know, create products which will, you know, I don't know, like discriminate women or other underrepresented groups, is to look into ourselves and try to make sure that, hey, oh, the process is what we can control, because there's a lot of we cannot, we are aware of them. So thank God, there's a lot of conversation about fairness and unfairness. And there are tools out there to do this kind of stuff. And I really like that saying, that what can be said about models that discriminate among cultures at various levels yields more actionable insights than what is a fair model. And I think it's connected to the bias. Like, what are the biases in my models? How can I keep going on it? And there's ways to measure fairness. And I'm not going to go into a lecture about like ethical AI and so on. But just look at these things like individual fairness, group fairness. When I graduated in statistics, more than 10 years ago now, I didn't learn about these things. Nobody teach me about data ethics, although we learn a bit of machine learning and a lot of statistics. Nobody, maybe a little bit we catched on the bias stuff, but fairness and then what is like individual fairness and statistical parity, nobody told me. So don't feel bad, for example, if you don't know these things, but we can learn these things. So I mean, it's 2021, cycle learning is coming out with the fairness modules. I know there was another talk about other tool, Daleks, recently, which I personally really like. It's time to add fairness to our ML pipeline. It's time to think about it every time we can, because, you know, nobody wants to end up on the headlines. So I have a couple of take-home messages for you if you work in data science or research or anything with data. What I personally think that it's time. So it's time to consider ethics as important as data engineering or any part of the data science work. It's 2021. I remember when the GDPR came, that was a nightmare and nobody was prepared for it. And I believe that the legal consequences of fairness measures are coming. So it's much better to be, you know, before like doing the work. And then the easiest start to do this is to choose someone from your team or hire someone who is actually responsible for, I would call it unfairness because I think it's cooler and it makes much more sense. You have a person dedicated who, you know, who will be in charge that, oh, okay, you are done with this model. We are predicting the rank of this person. Great. But did you do this? So make sure that it's part of the pipeline, part of the development circle, and pick any tool. There's a lot. So there's no excuse anymore. I have to invent it. There's a lot of them. And another thing is like, we need to talk with the users and the UX researchers, run a bunch of experiments and reanalyze our data with this eye, what we have now when we know about fairness and ethics and bias, which we probably didn't have a few years ago, or we didn't have time for it, but we should, and look for potential bias. And in order to do that, obviously, you need to educate yourself and your team. I put in some extra slides with stuff I like and stuff I recommend. They are much bigger experts than me on this topic, for sure. And I know this this data science meetup been talking about it, but yeah, you should do it. And one of the most important thing, I believe, that if you have a diverse team, and I'm not talking about only gender diversity, we forget a lot of other stuff, and not just race, age diversity, it's super important. Or are people from different geographies, languages, skills? You don't only need like, I don't know, business analysts, interdisciplinarity, it's awesome. And there's a lot of research showing that actually humans are way more objective together if they have like very mixed backgrounds, because we are selfish animals, right? So we will always look for something like, oh, is it work for people like me? Why not? And that's the cheapest, right? When you start to build a team from scratch, that's what you need to look into it. Maybe I can have like an anthropologist who can code a little bit, and it will give you much bigger value than you actually expect. So this is my take-home message from this talk. I really hope you have a lot of questions. There's tools, there's stuff. I put only open access publications I recently liked. And of course, join for the Women in Data Science Central and Eastern Europe Conference. It's going to be on the 8th of March, 1 p.m. to 6 p.m. You can join. It's going to be fun. We have amazing speakers. And thank you for your attention. You can send me an email anytime or ask me any questions. That's it. Okay.
Wow, thank you, Orsi. So this has been right on time and a great talk. And we have...
I leave this here.
Okay, I mean, sure.
This.
We have quite a few questions.
That's good.